After a RailsBridge workshop. My name is Alyson Long, and I'm an accountant at GitHub. I live in San Francisco. And actually, that is a lie. I am not an accountant anymore. As of 2 weeks ago, I've moved from the finance department to our engineering org. So, now I'm a full-time data analyst, and I'm on a team of four awesome, genius engineers within the engineering org, and I'll be moving beyond Excel and instead working in SQL and Bash and learning R. And today I'm going to talk about how I started learning to code by attending RailsBridge and RailsGirls workshops, as well as contributing to internal apps, and how in turn I convinced my company that I was technical enough to hack it on the engineering team. So November 3rd, 2012, I posted this to our internal company Facebook, which we call Team, and I had just learned what it meant to push, pull, and fork, and I was stoked to be attending RailsBridge to learn something called Ruby on Rails. How many people have participated in RailsBridge workshops before? Awesome. And this side of the room, let's way down. And do we have any organizers of RailsBridge in the room? Amazing. You're my heroes. So I know there's, I believe there's several RailsBridge workshops in conjunction with Rubyfuza, but for those of you that aren't familiar, RailsBridge is a free weekend workshop where women can learn Ruby on Rails with the help of volunteers from the community. And the students range anywhere from complete beginners like myself to professional developers and QA engineers and anywhere in between. Anyone can put together a workshop, as all of the curriculum is open sourced. So at the time of my first RailsBridge, I had been a GitHubber for all of 12 days. And at that point, I had never used a text editor before, I'd never used the terminal, and I certainly didn't know the difference between Ruby and Rails. And to be honest, at that point, I didn't even know the difference between Git and GitHub. So the workshop is 2 days long. Friday night is an install fest to get the necessary technologies installed on your computer, and Saturday day is a full day of mind-numbing learning. And I mean that in the best way possible. New words are hard, and I learned a lot of them that weekend, similar to how I feel here at this Ruby conference. A lot of it's way over my head. But during the workshop, when I got stuck, there was a knowledgeable person that could help answer my questions, and I had a ton of questions. So by the end of the Saturday workshop, I had this neat voting app called Suggestotron, which I pushed up to Heroku and shared with people who helped me decide on what I should dress up as for the next Halloween. And this was my costume. And this is how I felt afterwards. I felt empowered and excited. So a couple months later, there was a similar event, Rails Girls, which was put on an engine yard in San Francisco. And similar to RailsBridge, Rails Girls is a weekend workshop focused on helping women get started in Rails and Ruby. And how many people here have participated in Rails Girls events? Again, this side. And or any organizers for Rails Girls? Not yet. Okay, so actually, the rumor is that there's a Rails Girls coming to Cape Town in March. So look out for that and see if you can help. So by the end of the workshop, Rails Girls, you have this working Rails app that allows you to upload pictures, and it has a pretty bootstrap front end. For me, during this workshop, I spent most of the time changing the background color and playing with the fonts. That was the first time I'd ever really made a website, so I learned what Web Inspector was and how to change the HTML and CSS, and this was life-changing. After attending these events, I left with those warm, fuzzy community feelings. But the benefits were real and tangible. I built something that I could push to GitHub and show people, and I had this new technical vocabulary that I could use to participate in conversations with my coworkers and pretend I knew that I was talking about. Not only that, but my fellow developer coworkers were extremely excited and supportive of me learning to code, and I was hooked. So the foundation that I had from RailsBridge and RailsGirls gave me the confidence to submit my first pull request to an internal Rails app. We have a lot of internal apps at GitHub, and as I was bookmarking each one, I noticed that one app was missing a favicon. And as an accountant and someone that likes things neat and in order, and I like to audit things, this really bothered me. So I knew that I had the power to change it, though. I should also mention that I had no idea that the icon in the browser was called a favicon, so I had to Google thing in the browser and figure out what that was called. And once I figured that out, then I looked at the file structure of an app that had a favicon, found where it lived, copied that, created a branch on the one that was missing, and clicked Create PR. It was scary, and of course it didn't go perfectly. I had included a random file, so I got some feedback on how to remove it. But generally, the maintainers on the project, my coworkers, were really surprised and excited, and most importantly, my change got merged. And this is how I felt. Yay. So realizing the potential of GitHub to view other people's code and copy it was the key to me tricking those around me that I actually knew what I was doing. Let's be real. I really had no idea what I was doing. But it didn't really matter because A, I was having fun, and B, I was doing things, I was making things. So once people knew that I had started hacking, the opening topic of conversation turned to, what are you working on now? Which sometimes even became, let me know if there's anything I can help you with. Someone that's learning programming, there are no sweeter words. And trust me, if you offer to help me on something, I will take you up on that offer. Or I will offer accounting services in return. So one of my colleagues, Emma, needed some tax help. So we struck a deal that in exchange for help with her taxes, her husband, Glenn, would give me a Rails lesson. So one Saturday, we got together, and we worked on this app idea I had called Month Close that could potentially help automate the tracking of tasks involved in closing the books each month. And up until this point, the Rails apps that I had made were just single-page apps, and I was clueless on how to simply add another page. So I diligently took notes, and by the end of the day, I had a two-page Rails app, and Emma and Glenn had their taxes done. And this was my sticky note. Yeah. So around the summer of 2013, there was another RailsBridge and RailsGirls, and in the RailsBridge workshop, it was front-end focused, so I learned JavaScript for the first time. And I had a blast making pop-up alerts. I don't know why people hate on JavaScript. It's really fun. And the second RailsGirls I attended, I actually went back as a coach and a lightning talk speaker. Again, I didn't really know what I was doing, but I had a couple throwaway apps under my belt, so I just smiled and pretended. And in both of these events, I met some really awesome people that were really passionate and excited to help women and beginners get started. Enough to give up their entire weekends, and not to mention the countless hours organizers spent on logistics and all of the rest. To me, the developer community is truly a special place, and there's nothing like it that I've found anywhere in the accounting world. Again, I was completely hooked. So continuing on my coding journey, I had one specific coworker that was really influential in my development. His name is John Hoyt. Not only did he offer to help me, but he also became part of the finance team to help build an internal app for financial reporting. I don't think any of my accounting colleagues really understood why I was so into this coding thing, but John, as a developer, he got it, and he offered to pair a program with me, and this was life-changing. We did a How Ruby Works pair session, but for me, I didn't quite get what the point was. We talked about RSpec, and just so it wasn't clicking. And I wanted to know what the code looked like in the browser, what it looked like in action. So we went down another path, and we paired up on a project to write a Hubot script. And Hubot is our internal chat robot that we can tell to do things. The commands range from pulling up animated Beyonce GIFs to provisioning staging environments for GitHub.com. And one of our scripts is hiphop.coffee, which replied hip-hop lyrics from various rap artists. So we have Jay-Z me and Kanye me, and my contribution was to add a script, Drake me, which pulls up various important Drake quotes. YOLO. Again, I had basically done nothing from scratch. I simply copied what others had done and replaced it with Drake lyrics. John helped direct me which repository to go to and how to deploy, because I wouldn't have been able to figure that out on my own. So making a Hubot script was really fun, and I started having all of these other ideas of things I wanted to build and do. And the great thing about starting TAC is if you have an idea for something, there's actually a chance that you can make it come to life. And there's also probably a good chance that someone else has already thought of it and open-sourced it on GitHub. So in 2013, GitHub was hiring like crazy, and because I was responsible for payroll at that time, I knew everyone's name. But a lot of people don't go by their names in the chat rooms, they go by their GitHub handles. So I had this idea to make a memory matching game where one card would be the full name and the other card would be the GitHub handle, and you match them up. And so after about two minutes of searching on github.com, I found exactly what I was looking for. It was a simple CSS matching game, and even better, in the README for the project, they noted that the game was made from a tutorial in a book called Making HTML5 Games. And this was the jackpot for me. I cloned it down, I started hacking, and changed the background color, and added an octocat. But then I got really stuck. I asked for John's help, and as soon as he saw my prototype, he was excited and willing to lend a hand. So in a couple hours, we were able to pair and ship this hover matching game to the company, simply hosted on GitHub Pages, our free web hosting platform. And for a hot second, it went viral. It was really fun seeing everyone across the company playing it and competing for the lowest time. And to take it to the next level, John suggested that we add it to our internal app team. So we blocked out some time one afternoon, and within an hour or so, we added the .html file to the Rails app. And I was able to catch on pretty well since I had already paired with Glenn on adding the additional page from before. So soon enough, my contribution was merged, and I did a happy dance. So now, some real talk, because not everything is shiny. So on the PR to add this, there were 13 comments back and forth about changing things or why it even needed to be in the app. And I helped make the case for it, and after the back and forth, it finally got merged in. Fast forward a couple months, and the game broke. The picture stopped rendering, and I took a stab at debugging it and figured out that the URL for the avatars had changed. So I took a look at that and adjusted the JSON, and when I went back to check on it in the team app, it had already been removed by one of the maintainers. And I could have felt bad about this, but I wasn't really maintaining my project, and it went away, and I was okay with that. So that is my everything's not shiny disclaimer. So about this time, though, I had figured out a way to make my idea month close into an actual thing. One of my colleagues, Jaylord, had open-sourced a library called SheetC Calendar, which uses a Google Doc as your database, and then you can render a web page from there, either in a calendar form or a list. Also, I call Jaylord my open source superhero because she has the most amazing open source projects that are super accessible to beginners getting into programming. And so this is how our accounting team tracks our tasks each month. It's a Google Doc that's several hundreds of rows long with a due date on each row and initials to who it's assigned to. So using SheetC, I was able to turn Google Doc into a visual representation where each color represents a different team member's task, and the gray shows when someone's completed that task. And for me, this hack was the ultimate accomplishment because I was combining code and accounting. I was using all the skills that I had learned at RailsBridge and RailsGirls up until this point to do something that improved my day job. And then I went back to John, the maintainer, on our finance app and asked him if I could add in this HTML page, and he said yes. So using the files change diff from our previous pairing session on the matching game, I was able to look back and see exactly what needed to be changed where to add this page into the other finance app. And the PR was merged in, and I was so happy and excited. So with all of the practice that I had had after RailsBridge and RailsGirls and contributing to internal apps, my coworkers began thinking of me as an aspiring hacker, the accountant who hacks. I even got this email from a recruiter for an engineering position based on open source JavaScript contributions. Obviously, this is very laughable because my open source JavaScript contributions were from a tutorial, so, you know. And I was even the hair model for this octocat. It's the female coder cat. You guys can tell the resemblance. But like I said, my trade at the time was accounting, and I really liked accounting. I like things to be organized and in their place and balanced. But because people knew that I had these aspirations and I had the ability to hack, when the role for a full-time data analyst became available on the engineering team, it was the perfect combination of hacking skills, data analyst skills, and like my financial background. And I knew that I could do it. I had the minimum technical knowledge needed, and I was in the perfect position to switch. So the phrase that was used yesterday was MVP, minimum viable programmer. That's basically me. In this new role, I will be learning SQL and Bash, like I said, and R, and possibly some D3. And here I am today, giving a talk at a Ruby conference. And it all started with a RailsBridge workshop 2 years ago. So if you're an aspiring hacker like me, keep hacking, attend as many weekend workshops and meetups as you can. If you're working at a tech company, see if you can contribute to your company's chatbot or internal apps. And use GitHub. It's not just for seasoned programmers. Everyone has to start somewhere. Use it to view the source code on people's projects and see about submitting a pull request, even for the smallest things, like a favicon or a typo. YOLO. View the files change tab on closed pull request and see what other people have done and get context for the project. And don't be shy, ask for help when you're really stuck. If you're a software developer, get involved in these weekend workshops and offer to pair a program with aspiring hackers. You could change someone's life. So the question was, what sparked that interest? And I think it really came down to what I was doing in my day job were somewhat manual tasks, and I wanted to figure out a way with working in a company of mostly software engineers on a product that's for software developers. I wanted to figure out a way that I could use code to improve my day job, and that was my real motivation. So the question was helping kids get started in programming. So I know Mandel is going to speak on this a little bit in his talk. But yeah, I'm super passionate about helping other people get started because I'm like, I see the joy. And I'm like, I want to preach the good word and get everyone to learn to code. So I've started with my niece and nephew. They're 8 and 9. And there's a program called Dash that's through General Assembly, where you can make a CSS robot. And all it is copying and pasting from the tutorial into the text editor, but it makes a robot and it has like flashing laser eyes and the kids think it's really cool. But I do have a disclaimer because as I was teaching my nephew, I wanted to teach him how to like look up things for himself if he gets stuck. So I was like, you know, go to Google and use Google to help answer questions. Like for example, type in how to make a robot. So he starts typing in Google, how to make a robot, and like the Google autocomplete comes up, how to make love to a woman. And he was like, and Alyson, what does that mean? I was like, oh, shoot, and shut the laptop. So make sure you have like parental controls on your laptop. You don't want to do that. Thankfully, his mom still lets me do coding lessons with him. But yeah. Yeah. Cool. That's a great question. We haven't come out with numbers officially, but overall in the company, we're a company, the last time I checked, about 20% female, and I think of the female developers is less than that, probably 10% or less. So yeah, being in San Francisco and at GitHub now, we have a real priority in hiring for diversity, and quality are our two initiatives in hiring right now. And it's just really exciting to see, yeah, more women get into engineering. And there's coding schools in San Francisco that are dedicated to, entirely to women starting in engineering as a profession. So it's pretty exciting. Thank you, everybody.